St. Mary Eucharistic Mission. Yesterday we have a wonderful day, and today we continue. But we begin asking our Lord His grace in a way that we can hear with our hearts the words that our Lord is going to talk with us. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Good evening. I'm Madeline Pucci, the Director of Family Life and Service here at St. Mary's. It's good to see you tonight. The evening will follow with beginning with Father Granados and his teaching, and then J.D. will recap and put it into his own thoughts, and then we will, there will be a discussion between the two of them. We will open it up for questions. So tonight J.D. is going to be holding the microphone, so if you want to ask a question, I'll just come to you and you'll just have to speak really loudly so he can hear you, and then he will restate it so that it's picked up for our filming for the YouTube. So let me begin with the introduction of our speakers tonight. Father Jose Granados is the Superior General of the Disciples of the Hearts of Jesus and Mary. He holds a doctorate in theology from the Pontifical Gregorian University in Rome. Before starting his term as the Superior General for the Disciples in 2020, Father Granados served as an advisor to the Vatican Congregation of the Doctrine of the Faith, along with Cardinals Mueller and Ladaria. He was a professor of dogmatic theology at the Pontifical John Paul II Institute of Studies on Marriage and Family in Rome, which he was the vice president of. For these reasons, he's considered one of the world's top theologians. Currently, he's a co-founder and president of the Veritas Amoris Project, an initiative that focuses on the truth of love as a key to understanding God, the human person, and the world. He's the author of several books and articles in different languages. In English, Called Love, Approaching John Paul II's Theology of the Body, which is co-authored with Carl Anderson. More recently, The Introduction to Sacramental Theology, Signs of Christ in the Flesh. J.D. Flynn is a canon lawyer, a writer, and a Catholic journalist. He is co-founder of The Pillar, a journalism project focused on smart, serious, and faithful Catholic media on public accountability in the life of the Church. J.D. is an instructor of canon law at St. Patrick's Seminary in Menlo Park, California, and a member of the College of Fellows at the Dominican School of Philosophy and Theology at Berkeley. J.D. was previously the editor-in-chief of the Catholic News Agency, and before that, he worked in senior staff positions in the diocesan administration. His writing has appeared in the Washington Post, the Wall Street Journal, and various Catholic publications. We are proud to have him and his wife, Kate and their three children as parishioners here at St. Mary's. Tonight's topic will be a new covenant in my blood. What fruit can I hope for in the Holy Mass? It is my privilege to introduce Father Jose Granados.
covenant in my blood. We live times of uncertainty. We are not very much sure about the future. I want to talk about the blood of Christ as the opening of a future. And Jesus Christ said, if you drink my blood, you will have eternal life. John 6. Everyone who drinks my blood will have eternal life. At the same time, the Jews were scandalized with these words. How can we drink his blood? You can understand the scandal because for the Jews, to drink blood, the blood was sacred. God was the one who gave us the blood. So life is in the blood, and life comes from God. So to eat the blood, to drink the blood, is to drink God. And if you drink God, you die. In the same way as if you see God, you die. So this is a scandal. And on the other hand, we want to see God. We want to share in the life of God. To drink the blood of God, or the life that is in the blood, is to drink eternity as well. So this is the contradiction. We cannot drink the blood because it's God's life, but we need to because it's our desire. We need to belong to the family of God. We are called to that. So how we solve this issue? How we can belong to the family of God and enter into the time of God, into the time of eternity? This is the question. The blood is offering us to enter into the family of God and to enter into eternity. I would like to talk today about the Eucharist as a current of love, as a wellspring of love, which directs the current of our life. Our life is like a river, and we go towards our destination. We come from an origin. And the Eucharist teaches us to reach this destination, which is to belong to the family of God, through the blood of Christ. We have the example also of the blood that is in our veins. It circulates through the veins. And maybe it's better than the river, because the river can forget about the wellspring. The wellspring was my origin, but now, okay, this water will arrive to the sea. But our blood, which is traveling through our body, continually needs the heart that, is propulsating it, is moving it. So we understand that God is not only the origin that was like the kickoff of our life, but we need continually his presence. The Eucharist is continually moving us towards our destination. You know the story of the martyrs of Abyssinia, martyrs because they celebrated the Eucharist. And when the Romans asked them, why do you continue celebrating the Eucharist? They said, without the Eucharist, we cannot. We cannot what? We cannot work, we cannot love, we cannot play, we cannot celebrate. No, they said only we cannot. We cannot be. The Eucharist is our sustenance. Now, we can also say, well, if without the Eucharist you cannot, with the Eucharist you are able to everything. The Eucharist is a power. It has a hidden power of action because it's not very easy to act. We are distracted. We don't put the heart in what we do. To act is not easy. It's to take responsibility of what we are doing, is to get concentrated, focused, is to look for a fruit. And it is easy today, especially, in the society of the internet, to get distracted. The Eucharist is a school of action so that our whole heart can be given and can reach its destination, that we can really give ourselves to others totally, that we can concentrate in our self-gift. This is the Eucharist. Now, let me take three steps, because the blood of Christ is called like in three ways in the New Testament. The first one is the blood of the covenant. Jesus says, this is the blood of the covenant. My blood is the blood of the covenant. This is the chalice of the covenant in my blood, says St. Paul as well. So the blood has to do with the covenant, and here we find the mystery of the blood. The blood brings life. With the blood, we live. And the Jewish people knew very well because of the connection between the blood and the Spirit, and the Holy Spirit. How is this possible? Well, they saw that the blood when you kill an animal and the blood goes to the ground, there is something that comes from the blood, no? Because it's warm. So they saw that the steam, a kind of steam, was coming up. And they said, well, this is because the blood is bringing to our whole body when we breathe, our breath. The breath comes to the body through the blood. So in the blood, they said, is the breath. They didn't know the circulation of the blood, but they knew that there was a connection between the breath and the blood. And you know, in Genesis 2, at the beginning of creation, God forms Adam from the clay of the ground, and in the nostrils of Adam, he breathes his breath, which is the word breath in Hebrew is the same as the word spirit. In English also we say, inspire and spirit. It's the same connection. So they said, in the blood, there is the spirit. When you give your blood, you are giving the life that you receive from God. The blood is a witness that you have received life from God and you can give it to others. So we start to understand, when Jesus is giving us his blood, he's saying, I give you the spirit that they have received from the Father. I give you the love that they have received from the Father, which is like a current, like a river that leads you to fulfillment. So this is why the blood is connected also with the sacrifices. And the sacrifices are the beginning of a covenant with God. Blood, the sacrifice require blood. Why? Because it's the beginning of a covenant. We are going to establish a relationship with God. We tend to associate sacrifice with suffering. I'm going to make a sacrifice. No, and this is true. There is part of suffering in the sacrifice. When I say I offer it up, I mean it's something that is painful. But in Israel, the sacrifices were broader. It was not only the suffering, but it was the covenant with God, the relationship with God. St. Augustine explains this very well. He says, commenting on Psalm 50, you remember Psalm 50 is the Psalm of penance. I have sinned. And in this Psalm, which is said by King David says, you don't want sacrifice or burnt offerings. You want the sacrifice of a contrite heart. So Augustine says, God doesn't want sacrifices, but he does want a sacrifice, the sacrifice of the contrite heart. So how is this possible? He says, the sacrifices of the Old Testament were a sign. They were pointing to the sacrifice of the contrite heart. And what is to have a contrite heart? Is to direct our lives towards God. It's conversion. It's turning towards God. So you make a sacrifice when you order your love towards the source of love, who is God. You make a sacrifice which is a sacrifice of mercy. He says the contrite heart is mercy, because what is the greatest good is God. So you have mercy with yourself when you direct our life towards God. You have mercy with your husband or wife when you help them reach God. This is the sacrifice. You have mercy with your children when you direct them towards God. This is the sacrifice. You are making a sacrifice when you enter into contact with God. And you need the blood. The blood is a sign, because the blood is life. And by spilling the blood, you say, the covenant with God is more important than life. Even more, you say, the covenant with God is what is the foundation of life. This is the meaning of the blood in the sacrifice. You are acknowledging that God is the foundation of your life. Now, this is what happened in the sacrifice of the Old Testament. And so it's not only a penance, the sacrifice. First of all, it means that they receive gifts from God. This is what I said yesterday. There is a sacrifice on thanksgiving. Because the sacrifice do not start with me. They start with God. This is something that we don't realize. It's not that we offer something up, but first God helps us offer up. And without that, we cannot offer anything to the Lord. It is his action first. We see that in the Old Testament. You remember the prophet Elijah, when he was with other prophets, false prophets, and they were saying, let's offer a sacrifice. Let's see what is the real God. And Elijah prepares the sacrifice and says, God, send your fire from heaven. And also the other prophets. And Elijah says, your God is asleep, because he doesn't say the fire. And the God of Israel, the God of Elijah, sends the fire. The fire means that God is helping us to do the sacrifice. So to do the sacrifice, we need his help. We cannot do it by ourselves. He's sending the fire from heaven, and then the sacrifice goes up. And in the temple of Jerusalem, the sacrifice were offered with a fire, a flame that was kept alive continually. It was an eternal flame. It was kept always the same flame that came from heaven, came from God. So as to say, our sacrifices are possible because God allows us to do the sacrifice. And you see, we're approaching the cross. What happens in the cross? Jesus asks the Father that he sends his spirit from heaven, his fire, so that he can inflame his heart in love for us and offer himself up for us. So the first element of the sacrifice and of the blood that is received from the Lord is that it comes from him. We say that also in the Eucharist. In the Eucharist, this is important, in the cross. No? The cross is Jesus praying the Father. This is said in the letter to the Hebrews, Hebrews 9:13-14. God, Christ, offered himself in virtue of our eternal spirit. The Spirit of God comes on Jesus, inflames his heart from charity, and he offers himself up for us. It's incredible. And this is in the Eucharist the same. When we remember this dialogue between the people and the priest, you know, we say, lift up your hearts. Lift up your hearts. We lift them up to the Lord. And then what is the priest saying? Give thanks to the Lord. We give thanks to the Lord. Why? Why we give thanks? Because he has lifted up our hearts. He's God who lifts up our hearts to him. So that's the meaning of blood is, first of all, the meaning of receiving something from the Lord and thanking him for that. And then the blood is the blood of covenant. We receive from the Lord, but now we ourselves participate in this sacrifice. We ourselves offer up. Remember, we don't offer up only sufferings. We offer up our joys as well. Maybe it's a good thing to do. I offer up my joys. When we are joyful, we don't think of offering it up. But it's part of the sacrifice. So directing this joy to the Lord. This joy is for the Lord. And so when we offer up, there is the blood, there is now a covenant of the blood, which in the Bible is similar to marriage. And is the image of God who takes Israel as his bride. In the covenant of Moses with, in the covenant that Moses makes with God and in the people, he uses the blood. And he says, this is the covenant of my blood. What is a covenant in the blood? A covenant is an agreement. You know, it's something we do together. Marriage is a covenant in the blood. Because we mix our bloods. The blood of husband and wife become one in the blood of the child. So what Moses is saying is, this is a marriage between the people and God. This is the covenant. And Jesus himself in the Eucharist will bring this to fulfillment. He brings it to fulfillment first in the cross. That's also very important. No? The Eucharist and the cross are fulfilling that Jesus is the bridegroom. You remember Cana, no? The wedding at Cana. In Cana, Mary asked for a wine. What wine is she asking for? Of course, the wine of the wedding. No? She was very concrete. She was asking, these people have no wine. But maybe she was asking for something else. Because it's very strange. No? Jesus says to Mary, don't bother me, basically. No? I have, my hour has not yet come. But then, he will do the miracle. So some say, Mary was asking for two things. The first one was the wine of the wedding. But then she was asking for something more deeper, something deeper. Because in the prophet Isaiah, we say that God says to the people, they have no wine. Isaiah 24. They have no wine because they have no future, because they have abandoned me. And so they have no wine, they have no wedding, no joy. And this same petition can be in Mary. They have no wine. And now what happens? In following chapter 24 of Isaiah, God promises to rescue the people, and he says there will be a banquet with abundance of wine. So maybe Mary was asking also for the wine of the Eucharist. This is the explanation of a father of the church, Saint Irenaeus of Lyons. He said Mary was asking for the Eucharist. She was a bit impatient. Okay, holy people are impatient with holiness. So she was asking for the Lord to reveal himself and bring finally the wine for Israel, the wine of the Eucharist. And Jesus says, this is not my hour. The hour arrives at the Eucharist. Before the Last Supper, Jesus says, when my hour has arrived. And now he institutes the Eucharist. So we see there is a wedding also in the Eucharist, a covenant of blood, which is a wedding. And in the Mass we have this, when the priest says, behold the Lamb of God. Blessed those called to the supper of the Lamb. What is the supper of the Lamb? In the book of Revelation we have the explanation, it's the wedding banquet of the Lamb. It's the wedding of the Lamb. We are invited to a wedding in which we are the bride. So you see, this is the covenant of the blood. And this leads to something else. In the sacrifice of the Mass, it's like the cross is present. What happened in the cross is really present here. In the Eucharist, we have the real presence of Christ. We know that. He's really present. There is no more bread, no more wine. After consecration is the body and blood of our Lord. The body, the blood, the soul, and the divinity. He is really present there, substantially present. But there is more than that. It's not only the real presence of the Lord, but we really attend to the real sacrifice of the cross. Is Jesus present, and the cross is present as well. This is this is why the Mass is a sacrifice, because it's the way in which the sacrifice of the cross reaches each of us in our concrete moment in history. Jesus wanted that the cross accompany us all the way. Now this leads us to a second aspect of the blood. The blood is the blood of the covenant, I said, the covenant of thanksgiving, the covenant of marriage between God and us, but it's also the covenant, the blood of forgiveness for our sins. The blood poured out for the forgiveness of sins, because we are sinners. And in the Eucharist there is a death. Christ dies for us. It is a feast, it's a celebration really, but a serious celebration, because in the middle of it someone is dying for us. And this is because there is a death in the Eucharist, there can be a celebration, because this death gives meaning to life. So this is just not a celebration just for fun, for having fun. It's a celebration because something great has happened in our life. Christ has forgiven us from our sins. And this is the blood. Forgiveness is not easy, you know that. Maybe small things in your family are already difficult to forgive. More if there is a whole life, more if there is a serious betrayal. How to forgive when we have done something evil? We cannot by ourselves get out from sin and come back, because we have broken a covenant. We ourselves cannot remake this covenant. How to forgive? First of all, we need to say, well, I am responsible for what I did. Forgiving is not forgetting. If not, it will be very easy. No? I take a pill of amnesia and I have forgiven. Yes, take a pill, I don't remember. This is like forgiveness. It's not so, no. God didn't take any pill to forgive us. He really forgave us. But it's not easy, because I need to acknowledge, you did that, yeah, you are that man, that woman who did that, and this is you. So how can I separate what you did from you? It's not easy. There is only one way. If we can see that you are better than what you did. Forgiveness means to say to the other, you are better than your actions. And so I can go to something deeper in you, something that gives me hope that you can regenerate. And now I can forgive, because there is something in you that is not only the sin that you committed. Now, we can't say that, because we understand that there is in the human person something greater than what we did, and there is always hope, even if what we did was very great. But this is because Christ has forgiven us. The cross and the blood of the cross is to say, your life is so worthy that God himself wanted to live your life. And not only that, your life is so worthy that Christ, God himself, the Son of God, wanted to die for you. You are much better than what you did. Because Christ on the cross, when we were killing him, said, forgive them. And he affirmed our goodness. St. Paul says, Forgive and love your brother because he's the brother for whom Christ died. If Christ died for us, there is always something greater in us than our evil deeds. And if we repent, we can be forgiven. And this is, the cross gives us this strength. Now, when we look at our sins, because they are there, we cannot forget them, we do not despair. Because together with the sins, we see the death of Christ for us. Now, it's impossible to see my sins and not to see that because of these sins, Christ has died. And so, it's the love of Christ that forgives me. I do not despair when I see my sins. And this is the blood of forgiveness, the blood of for forgiveness of sins. This happens in the Eucharist. Saint Anselm said, look, in the Eucharist is a sacrament of mercy. God the Father is telling you, take my son, and offer it up for the forgiveness of your sins. And the Son is saying to you, take my life and offer it up for the forgiveness of your sins. That's amazing, you know, it's incredible. In the Eucharist, we see the transformation, what is called the transubstantiation. The bread and wine are transformed into the body and blood of Christ, the real body and the real blood. We need to think, for this transformation to be possible, there was a previous transformation, the transformation of the suffering of Christ, of his death, in an act of love for us, for the Father and for us. And we are seeing and living this transformation. Even suffering was able to be transformed into an act of love. This is the blood of Christ. But let me pass on to a third meaning of the blood. I have said the blood of the covenant, the blood for forgiveness of our sins. Is there any other meaning of blood? Well, I think so. It's the blood that is poured out from the side of Christ on the cross. It's a blood for fruitfulness, like a river of fruitfulness. You know, it's the heart of Jesus, which is open, and the blood comes. Now, here, the image is very clear. Jesus said, my body is a temple. John chapter 2. My body is like a real temple. This is why the body of Christ is the body of the church, is the temple in which we live. Now, in the temple of Jerusalem, there was, out of the temple came out a small river, the torrent Kidron or Cedron. It came out from the temple and it was a river, a small river of water. But it came, this water came mixed with the blood of the sacrifices that were happening in the temple. So all the sacrifice, all this blood came into this torrent and into this small river, and so it was water mixed with blood. And now you see the image, no? The temple, the body of Christ. From the body of Christ comes also blood and water, like the temple. The blood of the sacrifice. And in the prophet Ezekiel, we have this prophecy, from the temple will come water that will give life to everything. Trees and all the seasons will give fruit. This is the river, it's a river of fruitfulness. And this is a very important point. No? We are really, this blood gives life. This blood gives life. Do you remember many of the sacrifices in the Old Testament were about giving life? Abraham and Isaac is a sacrament of sacrifice of fatherhood. Or the Passover, to rescue the firstborns of the people. So I said earlier that in the blood of the sacrifice, you say the covenant is greater than life. Now, when is the blood of your son? What is Abraham saying? He's saying, the life that I am able to transmit to my son, I give it to you, Lord, because the covenant is greater than my fatherhood. Because the covenant is greater than the life of my life that I am giving to my child. Because the covenant is the foundation of my fatherhood. I can be a father because there is a covenant with God. I can be a sign of the fatherhood of God. And this is said in the blood because it's the blood of the Son. So this blood gives life. And this is why I think And Greek fruitfulness. And fruitfulness is what gives meaning to our time. I started saying that we live uncertain times. And now the Eucharist seems to open a future of fruitfulness. It opens up a future of fruitfulness. It tells you, your life can be fruitful if you rely on the covenant of God. So that's what Jesus is saying when he says, "This is my blood." He's saying to us, "This is my fruitfulness for you." And in a sense, this is my time for you. You can enter into the current of my time, the way I live time. You can receive my memories, because you know where you come from. You can receive my destiny, my hope, because you know where you are heading, like me. You can receive fidelity, because it's fidelity that allows our time to grow together, and not in separate moments. And so, this is my time for you. Enter into my time. Now, many times we say, we don't have time to go to Mass. Or maybe, I don't have time to go to adoration. Well, remember, it's not so. No. It's the Eucharist is the wellspring of time. Because without the Eucharist, time has no meaning. You win time in the Eucharist, because, first of all, you win memories. You know where you come from. You know that you come from the Father, that He is here to give you strength, to give your sacrifice, to offer up your sacrifice. So your memories are enlarged in the Eucharist. You have more time. And your hopes are enlarged. When someone has no projects, no hopes, no future, even if he has much time, he has nothing. So the Eucharist is giving you time because it's giving you hope. And when you go to Adoration Chapel, it's giving you time. You are not losing time. And the Eucharist and the Adoration Chapel as well, when you are there, it helps you to be faithful to the promise like Christ. And the promise is what keeps our time together. So we gain time. And now, this allows us also to see how the Eucharist gives this time, this fruitfulness, to the whole of history. As Christians, we cannot be afraid of the world, of history. Times are difficult. But we have the hidden power of the Eucharist. We don't need to go into a small community that is afraid and builds like protections, no. Because we have the Eucharist. We are not afraid. The Eucharist, all the history, all the plans of God for history, in the end, they are recapitulated into the Eucharist. What is happening in the transubstantiation, in the offering up, this is the whole of history from beginning to end. The world is going to end up there. We know that. So we're not afraid. St. Augustine said, "You complain about your times? Do you think that the times of Adam were better?" And then he says, "You're complaining about the times. You are the time. Change yourself, and you will change the times." This is St. Augustine. It was not an easy time for him, because the barbars were attacking and eliminating everything. Now, for this, we need the patience of the Eucharist. The Church has grown always through the Eucharist, starting in the Eucharist. It has been the patient ferment by living the Eucharist and by expanding the Eucharist to the whole of society, little by little, with setbacks, of course, with difficulties, of course. But it has been the growing of the Eucharist so that all the time of the world can enter here, because this is the real time. The other time is a loss of time and goes nowhere. The time that cannot be in connection with the Eucharist is going nowhere. So this is also the Eucharist is telling us what to do in the world, in our work, in the education of our children. We educate to bring the children to the Eucharist so that they can transform their desires into the desires of the Eucharist. Now, let me finish with a couple of images that recapitulate the blood of the covenant, the blood for the forgiveness of sins, the blood of fruitfulness. And the first is Ignatius of Antioch, 2nd century. Speaking of the Eucharist, he says, "The flesh of Christ is faith, the blood of Christ is charity. The body of Christ is our faith." Because we are grounded on the body of Christ, we said yesterday. We are grounded, we are rooted in the body of Christ. The blood of Christ is charity, because it gives us the direction, union with God, friendship with God. Now we can say that what Jesus has done is, this is an image to also recapitulate, no, what he has done is to help us drink this blood, which is the life of God. I started saying, how can we drink the blood and not die? You can think of the water of the mountains, no? The water of the snow. When you have snow, you can drink this water, okay. But it's not healthy because it has no minerals. It's too pure. In the end, it's unhealthy. We cannot drink directly the Spirit of God. But now this water passes through the mountain, which is the body of Christ, and comes out from the spring full of minerals. And this is what we receive in the Eucharist. The blood now is not the life, it's the life of God that has passed through the humanity of Christ, through his sufferings, joys, temptations, because he was tempted in everything like us, except sin, as says the letter to the Hebrews. And now we can drink and assimilate this Spirit, because it is the Spirit that has passed through the mountain, through the body of Christ. The last image is the pelican. You know, the pelican was seen by the fathers of the church as a bird that, with his beak, was able to, in his breast, he wounded itself to have blood for the chicks, to give this blood and to give life to the small pelicans. And it has been a symbol of the Eucharist. Let us again finish with this image that Christ is giving us his blood, like the pelican, to give us life. And with the prayer of St. Thomas Aquinas, when before the Eucharist he says, oh, holy, oh, pious pelican, Jesus of Nazareth, with your blood cleanse us, with this blood, that only one drop of this blood could heal and cleanse the sins of all the world. Thank you.
My name is J.D. Flynn. I go to the parish. Father Granados is one of the foremost theologians in the world, and we just had the pleasure of talking to him, and now here's me. So sorry about that. But I've been reflecting, you know, Father Noriega asked me to come and talk a little bit about this theme of the Eucharist, and especially this theme of the blood of Christ tonight, and what it means for us as a parish. And I've been reflecting on that, and I have a little bit of theological training, but I'm not a theologian, I'm a lawyer. And so I'm trained as a lawyer, and so when I think about things, I think about things like a lawyer. And when a lawyer looks at these scriptural stories that Father Jose talked about, that Father Granados talked about, a lawyer realizes that the Eucharist, that blood does do these things that he talked about, that blood gives new life and that blood forms a covenant. But a lawyer realizes that blood does something else too. Blood often, in scripture and blood often in law and blood often in culture and society, blood forms a community. Blood is the basis of a community. Here's what I mean. My son, Daniel, is 5. He goes to St. Mary's School. He comes home the other day and he says to me, Dad, I think he's learning something. Well done, Father James, because he comes home to me the other day and he says, Dad, did you know that we have the same blood? And I said, yeah, we have the same blood. He said, isn't that cool? We have the same blood, Dad. And I said, yeah, I mean, I don't know about science, so I think that's probably true that we have the same blood. Maybe he has a different blood type or something, but I don't know how that stuff works. So I just went with, yes, we have the same blood. That's very cool. And he's going through a cowboy phase, you know, so he's all excited now. We have the same blood, we have the same blood. And he's thinking about his cowboy kind of stuff that he's into. And he says, so Dad, if I fall off a horse and my blood falls out, can I have yours? And I thought, well, I mean, I guess, right? That's what dads do. But we don't have any horses, so I think I'll be okay. But still, my son had this sense. Dad, we're connected because we have the same kind of blood. We're connected in our blood in one way or another. These stories that Father Granados pointed out to us in Scripture are stories that are about God coming into the world in a new way, God giving us a covenant in a new way, but they're also about a way in which blood forms a community, a new people. Abraham makes this sacrifice, this blood sacrifice, and when Abraham makes this new sacrifice, the people of Abraham, the people who belong to Abraham, the people he's responsible for, become God's people. Blood makes these people God's people in this mysterious way of God's sort of economy of relating to us. And then in the Passover, the Hebrews in slavery in Egypt, they sacrifice a lamb and they paint the blood on the door and on the post of the door. And so the spirit of death passes by their house, right? And they're delivered in the blood. And we think often about them being delivered in the blood, but God also cements them as a people. In that moment, in that experience, they become the people of the blood, the brothers and sisters of the blood. We have gone through this thing together, and in this shedding of blood and doing this weird thing of painting it on the lintel of the door, we have become united to each other. And then those people go out into the desert. They're the people of the blood. They're united to each other in a new way. They're separated from Egypt. They're finally set free, and they go out into the desert, and if you're a lawyer or a parent or you just know a little something about human condition, you won't be surprised. They go out into the desert and they start fighting with each other, right? God makes them a people, he does it in the blood, and then they just grumble and argue and complain and fight with each other. And if you have my view on human nature, you sort of expect that's what's going to happen. God makes them a people and then they get discontented with it. God makes a people and then they get discontented with it. But God makes people, God makes a community, God makes a new people for himself, or cements his relationship with the people somehow through the shedding of blood, somehow through a kind of binding of the blood. And of course, in Scripture, that culminates on the cross, right? The Lord sheds his blood, and who do we see at the foot of the cross but Mary and John, a microcosm of the church? God cements his people, the church, us, the people of God. He makes this new relationship to us, the church, in the blood, in the shedding of his own blood. And then, in the life of the church, the blood of Christ, the body and blood of Christ, broken and shed, continue to form communities, to form people. St. Paul is traveling around and converting people, and they're being baptized, and they become the church in Philippi, the church in Corinth, the church in other places. I don't know them, but all of these people are united in different places, and they're united around the altar. They're the people of the body and blood of Jesus Christ in Corinth or Philippi or Galatia. They are united together in the body and blood of Jesus Christ. Blood makes them a people in the Eucharist. And you talked about that, Father, last night. You said that the altar is sort of the place from which the church emanates. Why? Because we're united to one another in the body and blood of Jesus Christ. It creates for us a community. We become the communion which is the church in our unity at the altar. Blood has made us a people together. And that's not true just sort of in the abstract for the church. That's true for particular communities in the church as well. We see it in the early church, where the sort of model of the church in the early church is that in every city you have the bishop, and then you have the people, and the bishop is very close to the people. There aren't that many Christians, and they keep on getting martyred, so they all sort of know each other pretty well, because they're sharing everything in common, and they're coming together, but they keep coming together and coming together and coming together for the shedding of the body and blood in the Mass, in the Eucharist. This is the center of their life. And gradually there becomes more of a distinction between the priests who assist the bishop and the bishop himself, and then sooner or later they decide, as you know from the book of Acts, that they need deacons who will serve at the table and take care of charity. But gradually sort of the structure of the church as we know it begins to take place. But all of it begins to take place around the altar. Each way that the church develops and each way that God's plan for the church unfolds takes place around the altar. We are the people of the body and blood of Christ. The blood of Christ has made us a people. And so we see that in dioceses. And then, as a couple of centuries of Christian history go on, as the church becomes a little bit more settled, as martyrdoms kind of slow down a little bit, and as the people of the church stop living so close to one another in the cities, but begin to have Christian communities in other places, the bishop starts to put altars in other places around his diocese. He starts to establish sacred places in other places around his diocese, other places where people can come and be united in the blood. And those communities that are gathered around those altars in kind of the suburbs or out in the country begin to become their own communities, real, true, stable communities of the Christian faithful. So the bishop starts sending them priests, not just to kind of come by on Sunday, but a priest to live among them, a priest to be responsible for their spiritual care, a priest to baptize them and marry them and bury them and do all of the things. They begin to be their own unique, distinct people, united in the body and blood of Christ, united in the altar. And that's the beginning of the parish. The parish as the sort of central locus of Christian life, the parish as the place where most of us experience what it is to be a Christian, is born of communities gathered around the Eucharistic table. The people of the parish, starting in the 300s, almost 2,000 years ago, the people of the parish are the people who gather around together for the breaking of the body and the shedding of the blood in the altar, at the altar in the Mass. The parish begins with the Eucharist. The Eucharist is the source and summit, the Second Vatican Council says, of the whole of the Church's life, and the Eucharist is the source, the real true source of the parish's life, because the parish is born out of those, the people who worship together, right? The parish is born out of the shedding of the blood. And so there's a really central kind of Christian identity. There's a really sort of ancient idea that being a Christian doesn't just mean that I'm baptized and I come and receive the sacraments and I'm sort of on my own with my family. There's a really ancient Christian idea that those early bishops understood that to be a Christian means to live in a community that is centered around the altar, to be in a community that is cemented by the shedding of the body and the blood. And as time goes on and as the idea of the parish becomes a little bit more ensconced, the bishops of the church start writing about the importance of the parish, and the great spiritual masters start writing about the importance of the parish. Sometimes bishops are also the same as spiritual masters, but not always. But the bishops of the church and the spiritual masters start writing about the importance of the parish, right? They start writing about the importance of being really connected to this Christian community, and they begin to talk about the parish as the school of charity. They say the parish, the community with which we gather around the altar, is the place where we learn to live Christian charity. Because the parish is not like a group of friends. The parish is not a social club. The parish is not a group of people that I would pick necessarily. I mean, I like you guys, but the parish is not, by definition, a group of people that I would pick to spend time with. The parish are the disciples of Jesus Christ who have gathered with me around the altar. The parish is that communion, not self-selected, not all strong, not needing things of me, but a communion of people who are strong and weak, who are sinful and holy, who run the gamut of humanity. And the parish becomes a community in the life of the church, which, because of what happens at the altar, is responsible to each other. The community of the parish becomes a community who are responsible to each other, so that by the 5th century, the 6th century, the 7th century, it becomes the spirituality of the parish to know that we in this parish are responsible for the poor in this place. We in this parish are responsible for the widows in this place, to make sure that they're not lonely, that we visit them, that they have the Eucharist, that they have the things they need. We in this parish are responsible for the orphans of this place. And that's not just sort of a piety. In those early centuries of the parish, that really meant something. We've got to pool what we've got because we have a real mission to this place. We are the people gathered around this table in the breaking of the body and the shedding of the blood who are responsible for Christian charity, the outpouring of God's mercy right here. That's what it is to be a parish in the life of the church. C.S. Lewis says that, he says a lot of people today like to say they love humanity, that they're really, that they have a real affection for sort of mankind, right? I want to be sort of universally charitable to mankind. And C.S. Lewis says that having sort of broad ideas about our fellow man, having sort of broad ideas about charity is really easy. He said, charity gets hard when we know the names of poor people. Charity gets hard when we know the names of sick people, when we see suffering people from time to time. And it's not just that they're suffering, it's that they're insufferable. He says that's when charity gets difficult. And he says we as Christians need to have this sense. If we want to have any hope of growing in the Christian life, we can't just have these vague pie-in-the-sky ideas about holiness. We need to have this sense that we're rooted in a community and we're responsible to that community. Because he says we're never going to learn to love sort of the poor in a broad general sense if we can't learn to love the poor whose names we know. If we can't learn to love the insufferable whose names we know. If we can't learn that what comes out of being at this table, the breaking of the body and the shedding of the blood, is that a lonely person who needs to talk and talks and talks and talks and talks and talks, that we have some responsibility to listen. Because we are being transformed by the Lord to love as he does. And he says, if we can't do that in the little Christian community of the parish, we can't possibly hope to do it anywhere else. So today, you know, a lot, there's this word parochial, right? If you talk about someone who has sort of a parochial mindset or parochial outlook, it's pejorative, right? It's sort of like, oh, they're very small-minded. They're only really thinking about their own problems. But the idea of parochialism in the history of the church is a virtue. The idea of being rooted in your place, rooted in your Christian community, responsible to these people, having your hand on the plow in this place and knowing this is the place where I have an obligation to be a Christian. These are the people among whom I have an obligation to be a Christian. And maybe if I get good at that, maybe then that mission will expand. But this is the place. Parochialism in the Christian life is a virtue. Knowing and rooting and sacrificing and being committed to this community that is built around this altar, this body, this blood. That's a virtue. That's the thing which helps us to learn how to love as the Lord does. That's the thing which takes the nourishment of the Eucharist and makes it manifest in our lives. And if we want to be saints, which is the only thing that's worth doing, that's the place where it begins. And today, I think in the Christian life, we've often lost the sense of what it means to be a part of the parish. Oftentimes, when we think about the parish to which we belong or the parish to which we go, we think about the one that kind of has the liturgy that we like or has the hymns that we like or has the people that we like. But, you know, we can become very easily consumeristic about that. We can sort of become shoppers, right? We look for the place that suits us. We look for the place that fulfills in our mind some idealized version of the Christian life. But there is no idealized version of the Christian life. In fact, if we go to a parish, if we belong to a parish, if we find this place that's full of people who are completely strong in the life of virtue, who are living a life of grace, who are completely sort of manifesting God's grace in their life, it won't be very good for us, because unless we're that way too, we actually need to be in a school of charity. We need the needs of others. We need the poverty of others, the demands of others, the responsibility that we have to one another. Because if we don't have that, we can't possibly hope to love as God loves. We can't possibly hope to exercise the patience and peace and kindness and joy and obedience that are the fruits of the Spirit. We can't hope for that. And so the parish community, rooted at the table, born out of the shedding of the blood, is the place where we learn what it is to be a Christian. And I think there are so many challenges against that today. There are so many things which tell us, go to the place where you're fed. Go to the place that is the perfect community. Circle the wagons, right? Go find the place, you know, there's so much bad out there. And there is so much bad out there. There's so much bad out there that we've got to circle the wagons. We've got to protect our own. I've got to find the place that's perfect for my kids and perfect for me and all of these things. But no, faith without works is dead, right? If I'm circling the wagons, if I'm sort of inserting myself into this community, which doesn't have a sense that our job is to love this community around us, and our opportunity is to love this community around us, and our grace is to love this community around us, and to proclaim Christ here and transform this place by the love of God with which we're able to love, then the thing that happens here at the altar won't bear any fruit in me, which means it will die. And the worship, whatever it is, whatever it looks like, will be fruitless. I think that's what I take from the idea that blood gives new life, is that blood gives new life not just for me, but blood gives new life for a community. And that's only true if the community cooperates with God's grace, cooperates too with the evangelical call to make disciples of all nations. And all nations is a big idea. But the idea to make disciples of this place, this parish, to make disciples of my family and the people of in the pews, just to start out with, that's maybe something I can hold on to, something I can grasp in a place where I can start. So for me, this idea of the blood is an idea of being a people together, united in the blood of Christ, and called to go from that into the school of charity, which is the parish, and then the parish called together to go into the works of mercy, which are the Christian life. So thank you, Father. That's what I'll be thinking about, and I'm very grateful for that. I think now we'll have some discussion and some questions, but thank you for letting me share that, and please give another round of applause to Father Granados for giving that. So what we're going to do now is take questions, and if you're like me, you have a lot of questions for Father Granados because he had some great things to say, and I'm going to start because I have the microphone, and then if you have a question, you can raise your hand and Madeline will find you, and then I'm going to repeat the question so it works on a recording, and then Father will answer it, or if you have a question for me, that's fine too, but you probably don't. I guess my question, Father, is, you know, you talked about the ways in which the blood which we receive in the Eucharist, the blood which is the Eucharist, gives us new life and is an expression of God's covenant in these things. How does that shape the way that we worship? How does that shape our place in the Mass, as for you, the priest, and for us, the parish?
Okay, I think what I wanted to say is that the Eucharist is a school of action. So it can say also a school of concord. Concord means acting together, no? And it is the basis of friendship. We are friends not because we feel the same, even if that could be good, not just because we are very intimate, but the definition of friendship passes through acting together, no? It's concord. So I think the idea of the blood helps us to see that we are in the same current with Christ, and we can cultivate in the liturgy, in the Eucharist, this wanting together with others. this concord with Christ and through Christ with the rest. You know? So it means that we can be active in the Mass. Not only, I mean, people who are active in the Mass, not only would those who come to say the readings, but the activity, the main activity of the Mass is cultivate this concord, you know, with our family first, the whole parish, as you said, you know, that are the community that are here, and with the Lord. So that the idea of the blood, I think, leads us to, and it has to do also with the capacity of receiving the Holy Spirit. So I come here to know what is to work, to know what is to educate, to know what is the action in life. You know? And I said we are very much distracted, you know, in our life. It's very much difficult to really want something with our whole heart. And that's, I think the Eucharist concentrates our heart in what it really matters. You know? And so the worship should lead to that, I think.
So I think you're talking, and I'm very grateful, I think you're talking about how the Eucharist transforms us as a community. But I guess I'm just as much interested, and maybe I need to better learn to pray, but you know, the Second Vatican Council has this beautiful expression about laity, all of us, called to full active conscious participation in the Mass, that we should be fully and actively and consciously participating in Mass. And I think there's been a lot of debate about what that means. What does it mean for me to really participate in the Mass? We can't all be an usher, or who would we see, I guess? You know, so what does it mean for us to actively participate in the Mass as the Council?
Yeah, the thing is, so what they said is that the full active participation means that what is happening here in the altar, which is an action. That's, I think, is important too. So it's, sometimes we concentrate the participation just in receiving communion, which is very good. I mean, having it in our heart and having an intimate connection with the Lord, this is all good. No, it's really part of the participation. No, I prepare myself to be pure so that I can receive communion, and then I pray to the Lord and I have an intimate friendship with Him. This is part of what it is. No? We tend to forget the other side, that is, the Mass is not only the communion, but also the sacrifice of the Lord. This is why the Mass is good not only for those who are receiving communion. Yeah, some of you come, you don't want to receive communion, you cannot, or other reasons, or also the small children, they come here in this way. No? They are not receiving communion. Are they not participating in the Eucharist? Yes, they can participate, and even for people who are living in sin, the Church says you need to come to the Eucharist. The precept of the Mass on Sundays is for you also. So come here, you cannot receive communion, but you need to come. It's a precept for you. It's a day of obligation also for you. Why? Because you can be active. You can be active in as much as you are offering the sacrifice, which is not only for those who receive communion, but for the whole world. And it's for your own conversion, and for the conversion of sinners, and also for the deceased. So the deceased are not taking communion, but they are benefiting from the sacrifice of the Mass, because it's broader, no? It's the sacrament that is good and gives grace also for those who do not receive it, the Mass, because it's offered for people who are not here, maybe. And so the active participation, I think, is how I come to the Eucharist so that my desires are transformed and are ready to let myself be transformed by the word of the Lord that we listen to in the Eucharist, by what the priest says, by the whole liturgy, and especially by the words of the consecration and the offering up of this sacrifice. So how do I come to the Eucharist? Is my desires are able to be transformed, to be enlarged, to be purified. I think when you come with the form of the cross, and when you receive communion also in the hand, is with the form of the cross. So this cross means I want my desires to conform to the cross of Christ, which is the love to everyone and to God. You know? This is what we have, you know, in the monstrance of the disciples. The sign, you know, the cross of the disciples, of the house of Jesus and Mary, is the monstrance. It's the cross, but the center is open for, we live in this center. You know? It's the two, you know, the arms of the cross is love to others and the love of God in the vertical, and in the center, the Eucharist opens a space, as you said, where you can live this and this active participation.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, great. Thank you. Are there other questions from those who are?
What are your thoughts?
Yeah, Father and I, it's funny that you asked that because we talked about that over bourbon last night, and got a little intense. No, it didn't. But this is something that a lot of people, I think, in the church are talking about right now, and I think you're right, it is amplified by social media. The Mass was, from the time of a little before the Council of Trent, sort of celebrated always and everywhere in the same way, and that was sort of in the West, and that was sort of the way that people knew the Mass, and then Vatican II happened, and the Mass was different, and that's a very short period of time, and in that very short period of time, there's an extraordinary amount of disagreement about what that means, and it hasn't gone away, right? There has been this sort of back and forth about liturgy that I think the Church has been experiencing since the time of the Second Vatican Council, and the pendulum seems to swing one way, and swing another way, and swing one way, and swing another way, and this kind of thing, if it's the sort of thing that you pay attention to, got intensified last year because Pope Francis sort of changed the rules about who could go to the traditional Latin Mass, the extraordinary form of the Mass, and who couldn't, and where it could be offered, and where it couldn't be offered, and those who loved it were extremely frustrated about that, and felt that they had been mistreated, or that that hadn't been fair to them, or those kinds of things, and so that has amplified or intensified this debate. I teach in a seminary, and seminarians love talking about this. I mean, my guys, it's like we don't even get to the syllabus because this is the thing that they want to talk about a lot. It was something that a lot of people in the life of the church are paying attention to. I think that there are, there is a real change in the way that some of the prayers of the Mass are prayed. There is a change, obviously, in the language of the Mass from the Latin to the vernacular, English or Spanish or Vietnamese or whatever it is. There's a change in the posture of the priest, and for some people, those things kind of can become so much of a focus that they lose that it becomes sort of their totality of the understanding of the Mass. But in a certain sense, while those things are important, while Mass should be celebrated reverently and with dignity and with beauty, those things are, in a philosophical sense, the accidents. You know, the philosophers talk about the essence of a thing, what its core is, and then the accidents of a thing, outside ancillary characteristics. What are the things that are not sort of essential to who it is, but are other elements of it. And those things about which form of the Mass, which missal, which rubrics, which posture, those things are accidents. They are. It can be disorienting. I think it has been sort of culturally disorienting for the church, right? And maybe there are things about these little things, how much do they help me to pray, and maybe a certain sort of form of the liturgy does help me to pray, or maybe a certain form of the liturgy does express sort of things which I think are culturally important, or sort of affirm things which I think are beautiful. And all of those things are fine. We all are humans, we all have preferences. But those preferences can become, I think, so preoccupying that we lose sight of the profundity of the mystery. And that's where division over these things becomes something which I think is which truly harmful to our Christian life.
Yeah, I agree, and I think, I mean, you can say many things. Maybe the first one is, at the center of the Eucharist is the bishop and is the Pope. It is mentioned in the Eucharist because it is part of the Eucharist. So it doesn't make any sense to celebrate the Eucharist where you are not in the community of the whole church. So the Pope and the bishop are integral to the Eucharist. They're part of it. And so I would say any celebration that is approved by the church, has the authority to approve it, is a valid celebration and is, according to God, also able to represent the mystery that we are living. So the first thing I would say when we start to say, my Mass is better than yours, or my Mass is good, yours is not so good, that I would say something is not going well in this way of looking at things. No? Because if the church is in the center and the church has approved the liturgy, according to, it's also the providence of the Lord that is leading the church, then this is the truth of the Eucharist as well. So it would be like trying to celebrate the Eucharist if you start with these comparisons, no? Say mine is better or not. No? The second thing I would say is that normally the right way of celebration has to do with the place you have been born in. It's like being born in a family and receiving a rite. It's always something received. It's not something you have chosen out of preference or because of, I mean, normally it should be this the case, no? That if you are in a rite, if you are in a way of celebrating the Eucharist, don't change. If it is, of course, celebrated reverently and celebrated with dignity and according to the norms of the church, it is able to represent, you know, the real mystery. But basically, I would say, yeah, what Didi was saying now, that you go to the hidden power of the Eucharist, to the body of Christ that is given in the Eucharist, to the time of Christ that is given to us. And when you have that, you know, you see that very well in the Gospel of John. The Gospel of John does not tell us about the celebration of the Eucharist. Of course, John knows about it. He knows about the Last Supper. He knows about the institution. No? But we don't have the account. We have the what Jesus says. No? But in John, like, he wants to go us to the fruit that is given in the Eucharist and to the hidden reality that is given there. He doesn't speak about the bread and wine. He speaks about the body and blood. And he has the strongest expressions about the Eucharist. No? My flesh for the life of the world. My blood is drink. No? In the other synoptics, you have this food is my body. This drink is my blood. No, in John you have my body is the real food. So it's not this food is my body, but my body is the real food. My blood is the real drink. No? It's going to the fruit. No, and I think this going into the mystery, which is of course, is part of the structure of the Eucharist, because it's about our bodies that is here, are here worshiping. No, I said yesterday that the crucial element of worship is our own bodies that are offering up themselves, and the body of the Lord, which is present to us, really, and His blood. No, so this I would say that go to the depth. No, and also I said maybe that's helpful as well. No, that the virtue of Christian worship is piety and religion, but as informed by charity. So the real virtue of the Eucharist is charity. Piety takes its form from charity. If you don't have charity, what is charity is the objective presence in the whole of the church and the community of the whole church, then everything that disrupts charity and creates divisions, it makes it difficult to worship, because you worship the body of Christ, and worship is friendship with Christ, which is charity. And our piety gets informed by this charity. That, I think, is also crucial.
Could I say one other thing? This is just my own perspective on this thing. So if you read a lot of liturgical history, as I do, one of the things you notice in the way that certain liturgical histories from the sort of late patristic period are presented is, I think, really helpful to this question. If you read sort of if you read liturgical histories from sort of the Eastern perspective and in some parts of the Western perspective even, from the late patristic period, the way that the liturgy is often described, there are these sort of manuals that talk about how the Mass is offered basically in different places and the different rites of the Mass. But the way that they describe it is so rooted in place. This is how they worship in Athens. This is how the Christians worship in Rome. This is how the Christians worship in Constantinople. All of it is sort of rooted in these places. This is how the Christians worship in Jerusalem. All of it is, as you say, rooted in this place. And that has been the ordinary course of Christian history, of liturgy in Christian history, for almost the whole of the Christian experience, that the people of a place worship in a certain way. And then America happens, and the people of all those places all come to America, and they bring with them their forms of worship. And so we have like all of these different Catholic forms of worship in the United States, not just sort of different hymns, but we have at the beginning, you know, in the immigrant periods of the 19th century and early 20th century, you know, Christians from all over sort of Eastern Europe and from Asia and from the West, all sort of having Mass in their own place. And so there begins to be this culture where in one place there's a sort of all these options, which is extremely unusual in Christian history. Not even in Rome could you find that for most of Christian history. And that plays into something, and so that then develops into this idea that there's lots of different kinds of worship, and then we Americans take that and we sort of say, oh, well, if there's lots of different kinds of worship in that way, then it makes sense that even in the context of the Latin church, the Roman church, liturgy would become sort of customized. And when the Mass was changed after Vatican II, one of the ways that the sort of implementation of that went wrong in the United States, very honestly, is that there was a great deal of sort of customization of that implementation. So the Mass that you saw in one parish would be very, very different from the Mass that you saw in another parish, would be very, very different from the Mass that you saw in another parish. So we have this background of sort of a liturgical menu, and then it sort of gets amplified. And we love, in America, having lots of options, right? The idea that there would only be kind of one kind of thing here is unusual for us. And so we just get very used to the same way that I can sort of pick what we're going to order, what kind of takeout we're going to get. I can sort of pick which of these things sort of suits my fancy or seems to feed me spiritually or those kinds of things. And again, I think it's okay that people have preferences and intellectual commitments to those preferences. I think that's probably even good. And I like to go to the Latin Mass sometimes. I like it. I find it to be very prayerful in certain ways. But I also, for me, the idea of worshiping in the way that my community worships seems to me to be central to the idea of being part of a Christian community. So it seems to me that it would be not only sort of pragmatically and tactically stupid, but also not especially sort of espousing the virtues of being in a family. If I went to my house and my wife made dinner, and I sort of said, "Well, this is good dinner, but Capital Grille does it better, so I'll take my meals there from now on." I mean, that would, first of all, I'd be in a lot of trouble, but second of all, it would just not be consistent with the nature of being part of a family. And it seems to me that if being a Christian means being part of a Christian community, then there's something to receiving the way that that Christian community worships and wanting it to be reverent and wanting it to be beautiful and wanting it to be holy and wanting it to be good, but at the same time, wanting to receive this thing which is a part of the community that forms me and that nurtures me in the Christian life and to which I'm responsible, and wanting to receive that in humility and wanting to receive that in communion with that community. So for me, I think being part of a parish is such an essential part to being a Christian that has to form the way I think about what I sort of order from the menu of liturgical options, at least for myself. And Father, what would you recommend, I mean, based upon your reflections in your talk, what are some of the things that you would recommend we kind of take with us to adoration to this time before the Lord?
So we are going to adore the body, but you know that in the body there is the blood because of the doctrine of concomitance. No? In the body there is the whole body, blood, soul, and divinity. So we are looking at, and it is beautiful also to see that in this body of Christ that we're going to adore, there is his blood. So think, what does this mean? It's like imagine a torrent that is coming from the Eucharist and is reaching you, and it allows you also to become a torrent of grace, a river of grace for others, and leads our life together, no, as a river together to the Lord. Maybe this image of the temple, which is the body from which water and blood flows, that reaches to us and allows us to give direction and concord in our whole life.
Okay. Thank you very much, Father.